Okay, can everybody hear me? Loud and clear. Good evening, everyone. My name is Matthijs. I'm an assistant professor here in international political economy at SAIS. And it's a pleasure to welcome you all on this dreary day. No government shutdown, but a hurricane coming our way. Never a dull moment in Washington, D.C. I already have this morning ritual, and every Monday when I wake up, I run to the door and I can't wait to get the FT because I want to read Ed Luce's his commentary on the American politics. Well, there's nothing different on every Wednesday morning when I wake up and I run to the door getting ready to read that long column in the FT, the column by John Kay. So I've been reading John Kay ever since I've managed to get the FT delivered at my door. And so it's a true pleasure to welcome here this evening. He's one of Britain's leading economists. His interests focus on the relationships between economics and business, and his career has spanned academic work, think tanks, business schools, company directorships, consultancies, and investment companies. So John Kay is here not to speak about his career, but to speak about his new book. His new book is called Other People's Money, The Real Business of Finance. And it's for sale here. I needed to remind you this from the bookseller. It's $29, and they accept all major credit cards. And this literally was just released about a week or so ago. And I think it talks to something that our students are very much interested in and maybe even worried about, right? I mean, it's now been well over 7 years since the beginning of the global financial crisis. And I think it's time to take stock and see what actually happened, what lessons have been learned, but also what has been done about financial sector regulation. This is not yet another book on the financial crisis. There's enough books on the financial crisis. It's a book on finance. What should it be doing? And also, how should we think about regulating finance? John Kay is not arguing for more regulation. He's arguing for a complete overhaul on how to think about finance. And will be talking to us about that this evening. I should say this event was only possible because the good people of Better Markets got in touch with me. Better Markets is a non-profit organization in Washington, D.C. that was, and Dennis can correct me if I'm wrong, that was literally founded with the Dodd-Frank bill. And they are a nonpartisan group that have been arguing and advocating for better finance, right, for better dealing with finance and regulation. And so it's a great pleasure to have to do this together with Better Markets here at SAIS. And we have the president here of Better Markets, Dennis Kelleher, who is the chief executive officer and the president of Better Markets Incorporated, which is here in Washington, D.C. on K Street. Dennis is going to provide some context to the book, some discussion, and ask John some questions before we open it up for questions with the audience. So Dennis he's probably the best placed person in Washington, D.C., come to think about it, to comment on John Kay's work. He has held several senior staff positions in the United States Senate, most recently as the chief counsel and senior leadership advisor to the chairman of the Senate Democratic Policy Committee. He also was a deputy staff director and general counsel to a Senate committee, as well as a legislative director for senior member of the Senate. He also knows finance from the legal side. He's been a litigation partner with the international law firm, and I'm going to screw up all the names, so apologies, Skadden, Arps, Slate, Meager, and Flom, where he had a U.S. and European practice specializing in the securities and financial markets, as well as corporate conduct and misconduct. Given that we're at SAIS, we have a big strategic studies program, I do want to mention that Dennis Kelleher has also served 4 years of active duty and enlisted service in the Air Force as a crash rescue firefighter and medic. So Dennis, after John Kay, will explain to us why we should care about the reform of finance, why we should care about this subject. I'll invite you up to the stage and then we can listen to your comments and have a broader discussion. So John, I will give the floor to you.
Thanks, Matthias. When I talk to friends in London who don't know very much about finance, they sometimes ask me the question, what do all these people who occupy these office towers in the City of London and Canary Wharf, what do they actually do? And the answer which I have to give is, to a rather startling extent, what they do is they trade with each other. Just to give you one or two examples, the total volume of trading in foreign exchange around the world is about 100 times the total value of trading in goods and services. A lot of people who ask me these questions think that what banks do is they collect our savings and they lend them to business. But if I explain that as far as British banks are concerned, lending to other non-financial businesses amounts to about 3% of their assets, and lending to other financial institutions amounts to about 70% of their assets, they're quite surprised. I'm bound to say, when I looked up these figures, I was quite surprised too. The total value of derivatives exposures in the world today is put by the Bank for International Settlements at about $700 trillion. That's the kind of figure that nobody can quite get their mind around, for good reasons, because it's about three times the value of all the assets in the world. And many of you will know, if you've read Michael Lewis's book, you will have learned a bit more about it, that a company called Spread Networks recently built a link across the Appalachians whose purpose is to reduce the time it takes to transmit data between Chicago and New York from 7.3 milliseconds to 6.6 milliseconds. If you can't quite grasp what a millisecond is any more than you can grasp what $700 trillion is, let me tell you that the irreducible physical minimum to that time, which has not yet quite been reached, is 4.3 milliseconds, which is the length of time it takes to transmit for light to go from between Chicago and New York. What is it all for, is the next question which my friends ask me. And that's a question to which I struggle sometimes to give the answer. After all, if we shut the doors to this theatre and spent the rest of the evening trading bits of paper with each other, we would expect that when we left, the world would be not very different from what it is when we came in. And the total amount of money we walked out the door with would be pretty much the same as the amount with which we walked in. It might be distributed differently. When I talked a bit on Tuesday about this with George Soros in the audience, I explained that if we were doing it with him in the room, it might well be that he would end up at the end of the evening with all the money in his pocket, and we would all be scrabbling around in our pockets for some small change for the subway home. The money might be distributed differently, but it would remain pretty much the same overall. So that raises two questions, which I'm going to try and address this evening. One is, what is the value of this activity? What, in fact, is the financial sector for? And the second question is, where does the apparent profitability of this activity come from? So let's switch to a slightly different gear for a moment and ask what most people find a rather surprising question, which is, what is finance for? Because let's be quite clear that economies need a financial system, that the development of really modern industrial society followed on the development of finance in Britain and the Netherlands in the 17th and 18th century. And we know today that poor countries are poor in significant part because they don't have an effective financial system. It's quite clear that economies need a financial system. And they need a financial system, I suggest, to do four groups of things. The first is that they need finance to operate a payment system. This is the everyday utility of finance, in which we pay our bills, receive wages and salaries, in which businesses effect their transactions with each other. That's the payment system, the utility, and it's what the largest number of people who are engaged in the financial world are engaged in. Because, of course, most people who work in finance aren't the bankers who are vilified in. They may be bankers, but they're not the bankers of popular legend of Margin Call and Wall Street and similar films. They're rather ordinary people doing rather ordinary clerical jobs in rather ordinary offices. So the first function of finance is the payment system. Second function of finance is wealth management. It's in the nature of our lives that when we're young, we consume more than we earn, and when we're old, we consume more than we earn, and if we manage things right, we have to do the opposite for some period in between. We need a financial system to enable us to smooth these ups and downs of life a bit, and to enable us to transmit wealth intergenerationally. That's the second function. The third function is the management of risk, and that's something which a lot of financial innovation in the last 30 years is described as being about. But all that's slightly strange, because if I were to go out into the street and ask people passing by, do you think financial innovation in the last 30 years has made your world more or less risky? They would look at me as if I was some kind of crazy guy. The risks that concern ordinary people in their everyday lives are the risks of Hurricane Katrina or Hurricane Joachim. They're the risks of illness, mortality, longevity, redundancy, unemployment, relationship breakdown. These aren't the risks with which innovation in the financial system has been concerned over the last three decades. They're risks that are generated within the financial system itself. And the fourth function of finance is capital allocation. And that's the one that is most often emphasized when I talk, when I ask people in the city to explain what it is they do. Lloyd Blankfein, when he gave a rather unwise interview to the Financial Times in 2009, the one in which he explained that what Goldman Sachs were doing constituted God's work, when the interviewer probed a bit more as to what the deity had in mind when he appointed Goldman Sachs to this particular task, he explained that Goldman Sachs was there to help companies grow by enabling them to raise capital for investment. Through raising capital for investment, he explained, there was a virtuous circle in which they grew, jobs were created, and so were profits from Goldman Sachs. We'll come back to that particular issue in a moment or two. But I want, first of all, to raise two basic questions about the effects of financialization. One is that most people seem to believe that financial crises are things that are just facts of nature, like Hurricane Katrina or Hurricane Joachim, that hit us from time to time, and there's nothing very much that can be done about it. I think this slide rather gives the lie to that. It's just one measure of incidence of financial crisis, but it's based on the incidence of bank failures. And you can see very clearly the pattern which is created on that slide. That is, through the 19th century, you have a gradually increasing incidence of banking crises, which accelerates in the first part of the 20th century, culminates in the great crash and depression of 1929 through 1933, but then you'll see that the period after the Second World War is a period of quite extraordinary and historically unprecedented stability. It only starts to change through the 1970s. The incidence of failure increases through the 1980s. In the 1990s, we experience the Asian and emerging market debt crisis. And then we have the brief period which Ben Bernanke christened the Great Moderation, which doesn't last very long before we have the largest recent crisis of all in 2008. What I hope you will take away from this is that these things are not inevitable. They are created by the systems which we have in place, and that means we can devise systems to reduce the incidence of these particular crises. The second thing I'd like to show is the ask the question, what has happened to the famous 1% versus the 99%? And if you look at what has happened to the share of the top 1% in incomes, I've taken four major economies, France, Germany, the UK, and the US, you will see that you get a very marked reduction in inequality in the share of the top 1% in all four countries across the decades from 1920 to 1970. Which is followed by, in the 1970s, that trend basically ends. In France and Germany, you see that it comes to a stop, but it doesn't reverse. That is the share of top 1% incomes in these two continental European countries has remained broadly constant over the last 50 years. The US story is, of course, the most spectacular, where the share of the top 1% has not only increased, but to increase to levels which are significantly above those of 1920, when actually the US was one of the most equal of the four countries. And the UK, where the increase, where there has also been an increase, although one which is not quite as marked. If I look at the top 0.1%, I get essentially the same kind of picture. One thing that may surprise you is the way in which income inequality in Germany is actually quite substantial. And that has a lot to do with the role of ownership in the German Mittelstand, the small and medium-sized businesses, which are actually the mainstay of the German economy. And we might find occasion to talk a little bit more about that issue in discussion. That, I think, is the result of that. But you'll see in the top, as far as the top 0.1% goes, the increase in the United States is even more spectacular. And I think it's difficult to doubt that this has a great deal to do with the process of financialization, that it's not an accident that the two countries that portray the most increase in inequality are Britain and the United States, the two with the largest financial sectors, the two with the largest expansion of the financial sector. And indeed, if we trace through the occupational distribution of these people to the extent that we can, and it's been done reasonably well for the United States, we see that there is a very high concentration in the finance sector, but also, of course, in corporate executive positions. And I believe, and this is again something we might want to discuss later, that the explosion, again particularly in the US, but also to some degree in Britain, in levels of top executive remuneration is pretty closely related to the process of financialization. So I've talked a bit about the functions of finance, and I've talked a bit about the effects of financialization. Let me return to Mr. Blankfein and his concern with capital allocation. According to Mr. Blankfein, you'll recall, capital allocation is the business of Goldman Sachs, and it's the means by which companies are able to raise funds for investment to promote growth and jobs. There are actually two basic misunderstandings in that statement. The first is the idea that securities issuance is actually an important part of what Goldman Sachs does. Over the last 10 years, it's in fact accounted for about less than 10% of their overall revenue. The bulk of their profits come from trading and market making of various kinds. But the second and perhaps more fundamental mistake is the mistake in thinking that raising money through securities issuance is the means by which the kinds of companies with which Goldman Sachs deal, invest, and grow. Actually, what has happened in Britain and the United States, if one looks at the figures over the last 20 years, is that net equity issuance is negative, not positive. That is, large corporations have removed more equity from the market by share buybacks and by acquisitions for cash than the total they have raised in new issues. The stock market, paradoxically, is now not a means of taking money or of putting money into companies, it's a means of taking money out. And one shouldn't necessarily regard that as an unimportant function, because an IPO now serves the role primarily of enabling early stage investors in a company to gain some liquidity event. As I say, that's not unimportant and by no means useless, but it's not what people saw as the traditional function of stock markets. Indeed, if we ask what the role of stock markets is, these are institutions that came into being in the 19th century, essentially in the first instance, as we know them, to finance railways and railroads. Now, these were capital-intensive businesses, and the ways in which that capital was raised was in small penny packets from large numbers of relatively well-off people. And the stock market existed to give them an opportunity to achieve some marketability in these holdings. That model was then used for other large capital-intensive businesses, breweries, then automobile plants, then petrochemical plants, and the like. But you will recognize modern business isn't like that anymore. Largest company in the world today, by market capitalization at least, is Apple, with a market cap of about $700 billion. Of that, about less than $20 billion is accounted for by its operating assets of various kinds. Apple, characteristically of modern businesses, is a company that has became cash generative at an early stage of its overall lifetime, and that's true of these businesses in general. More than that, these businesses, to the extent that they do employ capital in their operating business, that capital is fungible. It's offices, computers, shops, rare equipment that doesn't need to be owned by the company concerned, and typically isn't owned by the company concerned. Indeed, I was amused when I looked up the ownership of Apple's flagship London store, which is on Regent Street, to discover that it is jointly owned by the Queen and the Norwegian Sovereign Wealth Fund. That's the nature of ownership in the modern world. So that business, on the one hand, is capital light compared with its historic position. On the other hand, most savings are no longer small amounts collected from private individuals. The bulk of savings in the modern economy is institutionalized. So that actually what has happened is that we have far less need for public equity markets than we did a century or more, or than we did in the 20th century. But actually the activity in these markets has greatly increased. In fact, if we look at what the capital stock of a modern economy is, we find that it's dominated by housing. The national assets of the UK, about 60% of them, consists of houses, of residential property, overwhelmingly that stock of rented of property being owner-occupied. In France, the figure is about the same. In Germany and the United States, it's slightly lower, but still close to 50%. Capital in the modern economy is largely housing, and the allocation of capital is largely about a matter of housing finance. And it's quite significant, if one thinks about that and representative of the total, to ask how housing finance has evolved through the era of financialization. because it used to be the case that housing loans were made by people of rather modest background and abilities in office branch offices around the country, who would interview the prospective borrower in a rather minatory way and assess their ability to pay these loans back. And it was actually in the core of that model which produced the great expansion of owner occupation around the Western world. What happened from the 1980s was that we created securitized packages of mortgages, traded them actively in secondary markets, with two results. One is that many of these securitized products ended up in the hands of people who had very little idea what they were or what they contained. And that actually the process of generating information needed to make these loans effectively was worsened rather than improved. The financial innovation, which came through financialization there, is something that actually overall made the allocation of capital worse rather than better. So that takes us on to the ways in which financialization contributed to the profitability of the industry. Let's go back to my thought experiment and say what happens if we shut the doors of this room and spend the rest of our time trading paper with each other. How is it that we can actually make profits by doing that? Well, we can't, but we can persuade ourselves, at least for a time, that we have. And I think I found the key to understanding this is something that goes back to a book which was written more than 50 years ago, which I read as a student, in which Galbraith introduced the concept of the bezel. And the bezel is, he describes it, the amount by which the world thinks it is better off in the interval between a fraudster having stolen some money and the people from whom he has stolen it discovering that they have lost it. And for that joyful interval, both parties are effectively able to enjoy the same wealth. Bernie Madoff, of course, created what is probably the largest illegal bezel in history. And if you'll recall that the people who had invested in Madoff's schemes believed they had the $50 billion which turned out not to be available when Madoff was actually investigated, but they had bits of paper that established that value, while that money had actually been paid out to other people who had cashed in their investments with Madoff, or to fund the somewhat comfortable lifestyle of Madoff himself. Two people were enjoying the same wealth for a period. The money which Madoff was spending and the money which was being paid for redemptions on his funds was essentially money that had been borrowed from other people, borrowed from the future, and they hadn't yet realized that was the case. So we can easily extend this idea, and Charlie Munger, in an amusing essay, did so by describing what he called the fee bezel, the functionally equivalent bezel, something which has the same characteristics but doesn't have the same degree of legality about it. And this is perhaps an example of how it's done. And I wonder, this is the product which Fab Touré created. It was, of course, a tranched synthetic collateralized debt obligation. And perhaps there's someone in the audience to whom I can sell this bit of paper. It's labeled extremely complicated financial instrument. If you want a full description of what's in it, there is a legal document of 1,000 pages. I can promise you that there is no one in the world who has actually read these 1,000 pages from beginning to end. It has been put together on the word processors of large law firms from bits of earlier documents. But if you'd like to buy it, sir, this is a very complicated financial
instrument, which is actually, if you want to know, you may not want to know, it's a sub-senior tranche of a collateralized debt obligation based on residential mortgage-backed securities. I'm sure, since it offers impeccable security and a rating at least 1%, 100 basis points over and above US Treasuries, you and your investors will be interested in buying this bit of paper. And I'm sure you, sir, when you realize the bargain which he's received, might well be willing to give him a small premium to have access to this particular paper. And so it can go on. And I'm sure you there at the back of the room are interested in what's going down round here as we pass this bit of paper round, headed very complicated financial instrument. All of us are making profits, and I'm sure you won't want to miss out on the action. Perhaps you can persuade someone else, Mr. Kelleher here, who might be willing to write similar bits of paper for you to trade among yourself. And by this mechanism, we can all spend the rest of the evening imagining ourselves richer. Perhaps at the end of the evening, one of us will go home and actually look what was on this particular bit of paper and discover it wasn't worth as much as anyone had thought. Or perhaps in a year or two, we will actually start investigating the mortgages that are underpinning them and discover that they weren't much worth as much as anyone thought in the first place. We're creating a fibezel by doing this. We're imagining ourselves rich. And there are several interesting ways of imagining yourself rich. And I outline a variety of schemes of this type in the book. In addition to the Ponzi type scheme, and what we've been talking about here is a legal Ponzi type scheme. In addition to the Ponzi type scheme, we have what I call the tailgating problem. I've come to think of it as a tailgating problem because I have a house in France, and if you drive on a French autoroute, you will find that if you're driving at less than 20 kilometers an hour above the legal speed limit, there will be someone on your tail flashing his lights, usually is him, and trying to persuade you to get out of his way. Now, the interesting thing about tailgating is it's a strategy that pays off 99% of the time. On the vast majority of occasions, tailgating works, and the tailgater gets to his destination a minute or two earlier than someone who is an ordinary safe driver actually would. Occasionally, however, this doesn't happen. And you can see the debris at the sides of the autoroutes from time to time as indication of that. And it's true as a statistical matter that the accident rate on French roads of this kind is about twice the level of equivalent roads in England. However, when these accidents happen, it is almost always possible to blame the accident on some extraneous cause, usually with good reason. There was some obstruction on the road ahead or some other bad piece of driving that led to the undesirable consequence. So there's a kind of cognitive dissonance that dissociates the fundamental causes of the behavior from the proximate events that give rise to the particular incident. And I'm sure you can all recognize in my description elements of what happened in 2008 and the cognitive dissonance of this kind that followed it. You'll find various other ways of thinking yourself rich in the book. I'm sure it's worth the money for that alone. Because believing yourself richer than you are is a very comfortable state of mind to be in, you know, at least for a bit. But it's not actually a source of enduring profitability. And the truth is that only a mild caricature of the events of 2003 to 2007 is to say that banks announced they had made very large profits, distributed a substantial share of these large profits to their senior employees, and then announced in 2008 that it had all been a mistake more or less wiped out their shareholders, received taxpayer injections to which enabled them to recapitalize their institutions, and were able to pick themselves up and carry on pretty much as before. I've described some of the effects of financialization. I've asked questions about the value added generated by financialization. I could go on, if I had more time, to talk about the effectiveness of the financial system in delivering its other elements, in managing our risks, in wealth management, and in relation to the payment system. We might pick up some of these themes in discussion. But what I want to say in the last part of what I of this talk this evening is to talk a little bit about what might be done about it. And that's to pick up the theme of regulation. Because when to go back to my friends whom I'm talking to in London who are asking, what is it that people in the city do? Mostly I find they're pretty angry about what has happened in the financial system. And their reaction to all of this is to say what it's needed is more regulation. I don't think what is needed and more is more regulation. I think we have too much regulation of the financial system rather than too little. And indeed that regulation has in large part been a source of the problem rather than the solution to the problem. That a great deal of the complexity of the financial system, which I've been describing, has been created by regulation itself. That is, it is regulatory arbitrage and efforts to get round the impact of regulation, which has been responsible for the creation of many of the instruments which I've been describing. The truth is that regulation, which operates by detailed prescriptive rule books, has not worked really in any of the industries to which it has been applied. And that's the lesson of regulation more widely. Indeed, it's the lesson of economic management and economic planning more generally. If it was possible to write from the center a set of rules that would induce the kind of behavior you want in institutions away from the center, then the Soviet Union would have worked. And it didn't. And the idea that we are modeling our structures on of financial market regulation on systems that have been proven not to work in centralized command and control economies is a remarkable thought, but one that when we realize the reasons why that system did not work in these economies, we see that these reasons carry through to that failure as well. That people who do not want to espouse the objectives of the center will find ways of defying the rules that are set from the center. And you get into the ever more complex business of gaming the system of regulations that's been imposed. What I think we need instead is to look at a different philosophy of regulation. That's one that involves looking at the structure of the industry and the incentives at both corporate and individual level of the people within it. In terms of the structure of the industry, what I would like to see is short, simple chains of intermediation, a deposit channel in which rather boring banks take in our deposits and lend them on, primarily as I've described, for house purchase to people whose capacity to repay they have assessed. An asset management channel that takes our investment savings directly and which places them with suitably chosen businesses of which they have some actual knowledge. That it's a removal of the process of intermediation in which people think they are doing is hiring intermediaries to outwit the other intermediaries that other people have hired from themselves, a process which is necessarily in aggregate fruitless and is fruitless in the vast majority of individual cases. And finally, we need to change the culture of this industry
This was Fab Touré talking about the creation of the abacus instruments, which were essentially synthetic collateralized debt obligations based on a selection of subprime mortgages, which the hedge fund manager John Paulson had selected as being particularly likely to fail. If we go back 100 years, I find an English case in which describes the role of agents in English law. Prohibition of the law, said this elderly English judge, is absolute. It will not allow an agent to place himself in a situation which, under ordinary circumstances, would tempt a man to do what is not the best for his principal. That's the core concept of fiduciary duty. But by the time we move on a century, we find ourselves looking like this. This is Senator Collins. Did you consider yourself the duty to act in the best interests of your clients? Mr. Sparks, you'll see the answer is quite a bit longer than the question, and it's not entirely clear what one learns from the answer. Senator Collins repeats it. Mr. Sparks says helpfully, well, when I was at Goldman Sachs, clients are very important and were very important. Could you give me a yes or no? I believe we have a duty to serve our clients well. This is slightly later, again talking about the same transaction. When you heard that your employees in these emails and looking at these deals said, God, what a shitty deal. God, what a piece of crap. When you hear your own employees or read about these emails, do you feel anything? I think that is a very unfortunate thing to have on email. It is indeed a very unfortunate thing to have on email. Part of this reform structure, in my view, is going back to standards of fiduciary duty and, in addition, imposing standards of personal and corporate personal responsibility for the actions that take place within corporations. Instead of looking at financial services, this is what I call the shocked and appalled defense, which successfully enabled Rebecca Brooks to escape being charged with being convicted, rather, for the phone hacking offences of which had been widespread in the newspapers of which she was editor. We were all appalled and shocked when we heard about these allegations yesterday. I have to tell you that I'm sickened that these events are alleged to have happened. A rather strange phraseology, no doubt, written by some careful lawyer in the organization. Not just because I was editor of the News of the World at that time. And that takes me to what I think is an appropriate moment on which to end. Can we have the sound, please?
Everybody is to leave here immediately. This cafe is closed until further notice. Clear the room at once.
How can he close me up? On what ground?
I'm shocked to find that gambling is going on in here.
You're winning, sir.
Oh, thank you very much. Everybody out at once.
Let me leave it there for this evening.
Well, it's kind of hard to follow that, isn't it? I have no cartoons and no great quotes. But I want to start by saying thanks to SAIS for doing this and hosting John with us, and John for coming and writing such a terrific book. It's not just a lucid and insightful, well-written book. It's really important. And Matthias kind of alluded to this. Do we really need another book? And we don't do a lot of book events, and we don't host a lot of authors. And I think the answer is we don't need necessarily more books, but we could use a few good books. And this is a really good book that should be read And I want to talk for a minute or two about why that is and why this book is different, and then we can engage in, hopefully, with you on some questions on some provocative things John said. I think his description and analysis of many of these questions is right on, although his prescription, I think, is quite provocative and questionable in many respects that could engender some interesting dialogue. But before we get to that, why is this such an important book? First, it's an important book and it should be read because we have to remind ourselves that there's only one industry in the world that poses a threat to the global financial system, the economies, and the standard of living of everybody in this country. I mean, think about that, one industry. And that threat solely comes from the global too-big-to-fail banks. Now, too-big-to-fail is really shorthand, and a lot of people, nitpickers, raise questions about this. Too-big-to-fail is shorthand for too complex, too leveraged, too interconnected, too unmanageable, and frankly, and John's right about this, too unregulatable, if that's a word. It's interesting, John lays out some very good examples, including the particularities of Deutsche Bank, which in 2007 or 2008 had a leverage ratio of 50-1. 50-1. Not going to take much to sink that bank. And the interesting thing that John nicely spells out in the book is that actually understates its leverage because it doesn't include the embedded leverage in the trillions of dollars in Deutsche Bank's derivatives book. So it's when you look at these global too-big-to-fail banks and the threat they pose, it really shouldn't be that big of a surprise that after years of abuse and incompetence, arrogance and stupidity, negligence and recklessness, and yes, illegal and criminal conduct, the 2008 financial crash actually was the worst crash since 1929, caused the worst economy since the Great Depression of the 30s, and almost caused a second Great Depression. And I can tell you, because I was in government at the time, senior policymakers in this country in November and December of 08 and January and February of 09 were legitimately, genuinely, and constantly concerned about a second Great Depression. And in late January of 09, a senior government policymaker briefing other policymakers made the statement that not only is every economic indicator going down as it did during the Great Depression, they were actually going down at a faster rate than at any time during the Great Depression. Think about that, it was January of 09. So why is this book important? Because it brings us back to be thinking about the industry that poses such a grave threat. Now, it's not a theoretical threat either, and another good thing about this book is it drives you back to first principles. And so one of the first principles is, gosh, behind these numbers actually might be human beings, maybe people. And one of the things that needs to be reminded is the cost of the crisis to real people. And the cost of the crisis, and at Better Markets, we've done a study on this that's available on our website on the cost of the crisis. And lost GDP, the cost of the crisis is going to be more than $20 trillion, with a T, and probably more. And that's lost jobs, homes, retirements, savings, and so much more. And the interesting thing is the economic wreckage still continues. A lot of it's unseen, some of it's a little bit seen, you know, housing, depressed wages, long-term unemployment, but nobody talks about the fact that the struggles the Fed right now is trying to have with so-called normalizing rates is a direct result of the fact that they're not normal. Why are they not normal? Because of extraordinary monetary policy as a direct result of the crash. That context isn't provided when you're hearing about the comings and goings of Janet Yellen's latest press conference, but that's due to the crash. So thinking about and getting this right is a monumental and momentously important question. And those are the questions John raises. And that's really another distinguishing feature of this book, is that it raises the most fundamental questions that really need to be asked by all policymakers, academics, and regulators, or aspiring policymakers, academics, or regulators. And number one, he starts with, what is finance for? It's unbelievable how few people ask that question. Instead, they mostly focus on the bits of paper you all get to trade when you get into finance. It's really just astonishing. And so he further refines the question by asking, what does finance have to do with the production of goods and services? Another question. It's almost never asked, but it's not a theoretical question. This is not a theoretical enterprise. It affects the lives and livelihoods of all the people of the earth at the end of the day. So put differently, he says, what does finance have to do with the things that are important to people in their lives? And then he makes this prosaic but stunningly bold statement that, and I'll quote him, the objective of reforming the financial industry should be to restore the priority and respect for financial services that meets the needs of the real economy. Close quote. The real economy that provides goods and services, that employs people, that allows standards of living to grow. His conclusion, which is, he also details another key point, and this is another insight that nobody really wants to talk that much about. Quote, the list of factors contributing to the change in finance, and he does a very good job of detailing the financialization on a global basis. Almost every other book you look at talks about the United States. This is one of the few books that talks about the United States, UK, Japan, and importantly Germany, with some very insightful comparative analysis that you really will benefit from and you won't get anywhere else. But he says the list of factors contributing to the change in finance is long and has one striking feature. The change in the nature of finance had little to do with any change in the nature of the needs of the real economy. Close quote. I mean, think about that. There is this huge gulf and growing gulf between what's happening over here in finance, what's happening in the real economy. And he's right. The industry mostly trades with itself, talks to itself, and very importantly, judges itself by reference to performance criteria that it itself has created. And you wonder how they're enriching themselves at other people's expense. You know, it might be okay if we were talking about an expanding pie, but as John shows pretty credibly, what they're really doing is transferring wealth from those who really do produce the goods and services over here, disconnected to what's happening in finance over here, that's adding very little value to the production of the goods and services. And it's being done to an extent that staggers the mind, which John referred to, both generally in terms of the percentage of activity that's directed to the production of goods and services, and using the example of Goldman in particular. Another really service of this book is his. He goes back and he reminds people of the 2005 conference at Jackson Hole. The Federal Reserve Bank of Kansas has this Jackson Hole conference every year. 2005 was really a remarkable conference at the time, and it's a historical event that gets too little attention. That was when longtime Fed Chairman Alan Greenspan was being honored for his years of service on the occasion of his retirement. There was a global consensus that markets know best, that they could regulate themselves, that outside regulation was both unnecessary and harmful. The efficient market hypothesis was elevated to the level of a law. The so-called Greenspan doctrine ruled the day. Finance and financial innovation had perfected the art, now science, of managing risk to the point where risk was effectively or essentially gone, or at least could be best managed. And of course, as he alluded to, we were in the age of the great moderation. Essentially, the business cycle had been repealed, risk had been dealt with, happy days are here again, we'll all be rich, and nobody ask any questions because it might be a problem. So not only was Greenspan a committed believer, but also the cheerleaders for this were Ben Bernanke, Larry Summers, Bob Rubin, Don Cohn, Tim Geithner, and virtually everyone else. And indeed, certainly everyone in a position of power in government, academia, or elsewhere had to subscribe to that view. But there were a few dissenting voices, and the one who had the temerity to open his mouth at the conference, which John really lays out, I think, a little bit understated, was Rajan, I always say his name wrong. Do you know how to say it? Say it again? Radharan Rajan, who was then the chief economist of the IMF and is now the head of the Reserve Bank of India. He questioned the Greenspan doctrine and was attacked as an apostate. It's important to be reminded of it, and thankfully we have it here, that Larry Summers led the attack, calling Rajan a Luddite. And as you know, of course, today, Larry Summers and Bob Rubin and the rest of them have been appropriately excoriated. They have confessed publicly that they had no idea what they were talking about, that they led the country down the wrong road, and they are not honored or listened to as great founts of wisdom anymore. Oh, wait a minute, that didn't happen. No, in fact, still to this day, not one of them has asked, reflected on, or discussed in public any of the key questions raised by this book. What did cause, really, the 2008 crash to happen? What led up to that? What is the purpose of finance? Is it serving society and the needs and wants of real people? If not, why not? And how must it be changed? We don't all have to agree in the answers, but we should all be asking the questions and struggle honestly and openly with the issues they raise, which John has done, and that's why the book is important and distinguished from so many of the other books. And if we could just get Bob Rubin, Larry Summers, not to pick on them, there was a whole bunch of them, dozens of them, Ben Bernanke, to ask those same questions and reflect on them honestly, not in a defensive way and not to assign blame, but to really struggle with the fundamental questions around which we govern society and finance and its relationship. And until we do that, we're going to be caught up in a big part of the book that I won't talk about now that John talks about quite a bit, which is where do we go from here and how do we get there on an informed basis? So with that, we'll have some questions, I guess.
All right, is this on? We have about 25 minutes for questions and answers. Lots of great people in the audience. Can you make it a question and not a long statement? And identify yourself, please. Who wants to go? Who wants to go first? No questions? Ryan Connolly, PhD student in European Studies.
Thank you, and thank you very much for the talk. My question is really on that end about where we go from here. The financial industry is this massive global industry, and you're sort of, it seemed from your comments at the end, you propose returning to a model where the majority of investment activity is sort of regional banks doing home mortgage activities. So what is the purpose then for these large financial sectors? Is it simply foreign exchange trading, a little bit of export trading? Or do we have a purpose for this grand financial institutions that now exist and dominate the financial industry?
I don't want these large financial conglomerates to continue to dominate the financial sector. I would like to separate retail banking from investment banking. And within investment banking itself, if you ask what investment banks do, they typically engage in corporate advice, securities issuance, market making, own account trading, and asset management. All of these are actually functions that need to be performed, but they're all functions that conflict with each other, and in my view should not be performed in a single institution. So that one would have, and the parts of that activity that actually involve taking risks, which are, you know, market making, own account trading, and to some degree securities issuance, should not be undertaken by very large public limited companies, private limited liability corporations with widely dispersed shareholders and widely dispersed depositors at risk as well. I would like to see an asset management sector, as I've described, that is focused much more on developing concentrated portfolios of investments about which they are well informed, an asset management sector that performs what I see as being the essential functions of capital allocation, which are search for new investment opportunities and stewardship of assets, whether physical or corporate, that have already been created. That's the kind of structure of an industry I would like to see. It doesn't, in my view, it's not a picked landscape in which these large financial conglomerates play a part, but most of the activities which take place within them continue to take place, although in many cases at a much smaller scale.
Can I just make a quick comment, too? It's important to remember, in the United States, there's just under 6,500 banks. Less than two dozen have more than $100 billion in assets.
Right? So you're talking about, when you're talking about these banks that pose the biggest threat, that really are the problem, you're talking about a very small handful of banks. And think about this. In the United States, so there's about $700 trillion worldwide in derivatives, about half, a little more than that, between $350, $400 trillion in the United States. Only four banks in the United States control about 95% of that derivatives market. So when you talk about the industry and what to do and how to do, we're not talking about having to deal with hundreds of institutions. We have a very small number of institutions that engage in, at the extreme level, the activities John's talking about. And that's where the focus has to be in terms of determining how best to rebalance this industry and get back to a point where finance serves society instead of finance being a parasite on society. And by finance, I think about it a little bit differently. And John, I'd like to know what you think. I think of it as the difference between banking and finance. I think of the two dozen or so banks engaged much more in finance and paper trading and derivatives and FICC, and you look at the other 6,000 some odd banks that have relatively straightforward balance sheets and engage in relatively straightforward activities. And so I think of banking and finance as being a little bit different.
Yeah, I mean, there is a banking activity which continues. You've talked about in the United States and community banks. In Germany, which, as was hinted, I talk a bit about in the book, you have actually the extraordinary contrast of Deutsche Bank at one end as the world's largest leveraged hedge fund, and the community and savings banks, which are actually a very large part of the total balance sheets of the rest of the German banking system, which are very much embedded in local communities and are part of the support for the Mittelstand, which I was describing.
More questions?
Yeah, Jim Allen with CFA Institute. Your comment about the, of course, the payments business is almost like the standard beta for banks, but they always sort of try to do alpha with the lending side, which creates problems. I have the distinct pleasure of having been a bank analyst in Texas in the 1980s. They were never terribly big, but they all were sort of concentrated in one area. I guess one of the big things that seems to be still within your system is the idea of, what is it, maturity transformation. I call it maturity alchemy, but maturity transformation. How would your system deal with that particular problem?
Largely in the old-fashioned way in which maturity transformation was dealt with. You know, by banks, which part of this issue, and one of the things I discuss in the book, is people have this idea that finance is special in a whole variety of ways. And perhaps the largest emphasis on this is that banks create money in particular, right, in some uniquely special way. I try to puncture that by saying actually what they're doing is they're making promises to us that we can recoup our deposits on demand, promises which are only viable because they're not called on by very many people. Now, that's actually how the whole economy works. You know, that we all believe we can get on a plane from Washington to New York if we want. And that's all true, although if any small, large fraction of the people who believe that actually did it, they wouldn't be able to do so. We all know that if we plug an appliance into the socket, electricity will come out. But if everyone who wanted to do it did it, they wouldn't be able to do it. And so on. Our whole economy depends on, and the efficiency of our economy depends on, what are just different versions of this maturity transformation problem. It's maintaining enough spare capacity and enough confidence in the system to ensure that we can function with these things in our day-to-day lives without suffering acute shortages and the like. And if one asks, goes back to the question of why the Soviet Union didn't work, one of the reasons was it didn't actually manage to pull off that trick effectively, you know, maintaining the stocks and the confidence necessary to enable markets to function in that particular way. So boring banks do it in the old-fashioned way by maintaining sufficient liquidity and sufficient confidence in their activities to enable the appearance of liquidity to be generated, even though the nature of the loan book is such that the underlying reality couldn't be.
Yeah, it's Mike Easterly. You had said that the transformation of the financial system came without any sort of demand from the, you know, real economy. Essentially, it came out about because of situations in the financial economy, namely interest rates. So if you had a depository institution and interest rates went up, they suddenly became insolvent, as they did in the 70s. And so I'm wondering, you know, is this, by going back to, I assume that what you're saying is we should go back to a more of a depository model. Are we just trading one risk for another?
But you in the United States had, and indeed to a large degree have, this rather peculiar model in which you have fixed rate mortgages set for term, funded by short term deposits. One simply has to describe that system to see that it's not very likely to prove stable. And that's perhaps part of the reason why this is the only major country in the world that has it. And you've tried to sustain it by inventing parastatal institutions in Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac to try and stabilize the situation. In contrast, in the UK, you basically have variable rate mortgages against variable rate deposits. In Germany, you actually have fixed rate mortgages, but you don't have unilateral rights to repayment, so that if you redeem your mortgage ahead of term, which of course most people don't because they prefer to transfer their mortgage to a new property, but if you do redeem your mortgage ahead of term, you have to pay the same kind of mark-to-market penalty that you would if you had undertaken it in a swap market. I think it's wrong to say that it was that particular problem that was the driver of what I've described as financialization. But it's important to say that there is a problem there that was a peculiarly US problem, and it's a problem which is still remains in the particularities of US institutions.
Mm-hmm. Other questions? Yes, David Steinberg in the back, please.
Hi, thanks. I was wondering if you could comment on whether you think it's realistic to get where you want to go and how, given current political realities, you think that might happen. Even if we agree that what you're suggesting is the best.
I have two responses to that. Right, it's obvious enough that where we are today in terms of the political power of the large financial services businesses, we're not going to make significant progress in the direction which I've described. But one answer I give is to say that what is politically possible changes pretty dramatically over a period of years. I ask how many people 20 or 30 years ago would have thought that United States would have a black president and would have legalized gay marriage. What is politically possible in that sense changes over time. The second observation is I think the only way we're going to get meaningful reform is in the next financial crisis, and it seems to me inescapable that there will be a next financial crisis. And what I'm hoping to try and do in a book like this is to present some ideas which could be in the minds of policymakers when the next financial crisis occurs. Because Rahm Emanuel famously said, never let a good crisis go to waste. But of course in 2008 they did let the good crisis go to waste. I'd like to give at least, and perhaps that was inevitable because policymakers didn't know what to do except to say to failing banks, how much money do you want? I hope they will have some better ideas about what to do in future.
Actually, I would love to know what you think about this, Dennis, about this question, because I mean, you've been in that part of the world.
You know, I don't think I want to be quite as pessimistic as John, where I would hope it's not going to take another financial crisis to do that. It's going to take something that galvanizes the public, but we're in a vicious circle right now, or a vicious cycle, where finance is incredibly wealthy, and it is using its economic power to purchase political power. And unfortunately, the legal system is actually increasing their ability to purchase political power, which they use to get more economic power. So we're unfortunately in a circumstance of working the wrong way. On the other hand, there's clearly, and I can only speak to the United States, I don't know about the other countries, but there's clearly a feeling in this country, quite broad-based, that what people generally call Wall Street, and by that they mean the big finance, too big to fail banks, are a threat. They need to be regulated, and the government has done a bad job of doing that. There's bipartisan majorities, you see them in all the polls, and that's why you have everybody from Ted Cruz to Bernie Sanders in the political debates right now calling for getting tougher on finance and Wall Street. So when you see both Republicans and Democrats saying it, you know it's being reflected broad-based in the polls. So there is a way between now and then, and I'm not as pessimistic about regulation either. The truth is there was massive regulation after the Great Depression that worked quite well for many decades. Now that's for a lot of different reasons and it's a moment in time, but I think it's a good counterexample that we know how to regulate finance and we know how to do it effectively through a business cycle, through several business cycles, not perfectly, but well enough to avoid historic financial crashes. So one would hope that that's still possible, mm-hmm. short of a crash. Because if you think about the human wreckage from a financial crash, just at the human level, we all and everybody have a duty to do what we can to make sure there isn't another crash. I mean, there really is several lost generations in different countries across this world of people, poverty, homelessness, hopelessness, lost jobs, lost homes, lost retirements, lost savings, people without health care that should have health care. I mean, we detail it in the Cost of the Crisis report, and I'll tell you, anybody who reflects for a minute on the human and economic wreckage of a historic financial crash ought to be doing everything they can to make sure the next one doesn't happen.
Now, just pick up a couple of points on that. One is, you say rightly that regulation was relatively effective post the Wall Street crash, the depression that followed. It's quite important to say that that is in part because regulation then focused very largely on structural issues. I forget how long the Glass-Steagall Act was. My understanding is it was about 3 or 4 pages, in contrast to the 1,000 pages of Dodd-Frank, plus the regulations that followed Dodd-Frank. The second point is that around the world, I think, we have what in a sense you're describing for the US, which is this rather unfocused public anger about what has happened in the financial system. An unfocused public anger that has extended towards and aggravated a dissatisfaction with the performance of mainstream politicians as a whole. And although Donald Trump and Jeremy Corbyn don't have very much in common, what they do have in common, and a large part of the reason for their appeal, is that they are very clearly not the conventional political mainstream. And what we're learning is that almost anyone who offers that particular ticket to voters wins substantial public support. I think that's a very scary position for us to be in, and I think it's really important that mainstream democratic politicians understand that and realize they have to respond to the challenges which are posed.
Well, one of the real costs of the crisis that nobody talks about is the absolute corrosion of the public's confidence and trust in government and institutions generally. In the United States, what you see in all the polling shows this, is they think, you know, Washington and Wall Street are in bed together, that everybody's corrupt. They see Wall Street get bailed out. They see Main Street get handed the bill, and kind of the cliche. Unfortunately, too much of it is being characterized as kind of anger and diffused anger. This is, I think it's legitimate expressions of concerns of what they have observed, both what their government has done and what they have seen on Main Street in terms of jobs and activities. But you're right, I mean, one of the big costs of the crash, the unacknowledged cost, is the utter kind of erosion of trust and confidence in the government, and then what now appears to be pretty clearly a double standard of justice, what kind of Wall Street gets off with little fines, Main Street gets the book thrown at them. And I think we're seeing that manifested not just in the race, you know, with Corbyn in the UK and in the United States, but kind of around the world. You go to Spain or Italy, Greece, maybe Germany's the only island so far that hasn't been hit that way, but that's coming.
But they also have a real manufacturing. But I think that's the main point of the graph you showed of Reinhardt and Rogoff's data. I mean, they say this time is different, and they mean it ironic. But the point is the 50s and the 60s
were different.
They were different. Yeah. Right? There were no crises, and there was kind of a general increase in standards of living and lowering of income inequality. And just to David's question, I mean, the one thing which strikes me, for anybody, and we have Mark Blythe here, who studied the 70s probably more than anybody in this room. If you study the 70s, it's amazing how labor union leaders also felt invincible, right? And they talked this talk of like, you know, there's nothing the government can do against it. It had a certain sense of structural power. And if you hear bankers talk in 2007, 2009 crisis, I felt a very similar feeling, that they kind of assumed that, well, government will do what they want anyway, because they've kind of controlled them. And so these things do change very, I mean, not quickly. One crisis would do it, but I think over time people start thinking very differently about this.
And that is true, and I think a lot of people, I've certainly also felt the analogy between the power of trade unions in the 1970s and the power of the financial sector in recent years. And people, as we all know, wrote in the 1970s about how Britain is ungovernable because of this structure. And then Mrs. Thatcher came along, and you may not like it all, but she demonstrated that Britain was governable after all. Right? Maybe we can do the same in this case.
Yeah. Let's round up a couple more questions, because we have a couple more minutes. Let's start there. Yeah.
I'm Nicholas Kessels from the Freie University in Berlin. My question goes along what you just said, whether or not or how likely change really is, because the picture seems to be very dark. The next crisis will come. The industry feels very confident in its saddle. Now, my question would be, with international approaches aiming at raising capital, establishing TLAC by 2019, so making large companies, financial behemoths, getting resolution authority over these corporations, Is raising the amount of capital within these firms actually a good first step to make these structural changes once the next crisis hits?
Okay, and can we have your question as well?
Hal Rillingham in the MIPP program. I'm just curious, I'm happy you acknowledge also that regulation is sometimes the source of financial instability down the road, and the fact that we're having this conversation 7 years after the crisis, what is the best regulation to use after Dodd-Frank was passed and there was a sort of a flurry of regulation right after the crisis. I'm just curious as to what your view specifically to the U.S. is in terms of the effectiveness of Dodd-Frank and other legislation, regulation which was passed after the crisis, given the fact that 7 years later, it's arguably mortgage lending is still impaired. You have small credit unions which are feeling overly regulated and fear that there's just going to be more consolidation in the banking sector, leading to the same problems we're talking about.
I think more capital and resolution are moves in the right direction, but they're actually pretty small moves. Firstly, the amount of additional capital that you would require to stabilize the existing structure of the structure of the existing balance sheets of banks is not just a bit more, as in Basel. It is kind of orders of magnitude more, amounts that are in fact essentially unavailable from equity markets, and to encourage banks to raise their capital by essentially allowing them to borrow very large amounts of money from the government at very low interest rates
and pass them on at much higher interest rates to their customers, as well as using the money to make profits from trading, seems to me not a move in the right direction. Equally, I'd like to see the resolution authority being effectively used. At the moment, I think we have a kind of humbug on both sides of the Atlantic. You know, Obama announced the period of bailouts is over, while his Treasury Secretary was signaling very much the opposite and explaining at length in in his memoirs how important it was that large institutions should be bailed out in time of trouble. In Europe, there was an almost Hamlet-like short interval between the announcement that the era of bailouts was over and the next bailout of a failed large Portuguese bank. We have to mean it, and we're very far from meaning it at the moment.
I think it's important to remember in terms of Dodd-Frank, you know, I was once accused of testifying at some committee, and one of the members accused me of saying, oh, you think Dodd-Frank is perfect. And no law is perfect. The Dodd-Frank law is the best law that this government could produce at the time under those circumstances. It's that simple. On the other hand, as somebody who had kind of a front row seat for all of it, I do think that Dodd-Frank has within it all the pieces necessary to substantively address to reduce the risk and to eliminate some of the risk of the most egregious activities. Something John just said that's very insightful is that, you know, that you can, the equity markets don't have enough available to provide sufficient equity for the banks, capital for the banks. But that what that really tells you is that it's an unsustainable business model absent the public subsidy. And so the question becomes, if that's the case, how do you make the banks and kind of the economist approach to it internalize as much of the cost that they're externalizing? And when you look at Dodd-Frank, it's capital, it's liquidity, it's counterparty exposure, it's taking the derivatives market from OTC and unregulated to putting it regulated, transparency with creating competition. And so at some point, there'll be a tipping point on the business model. So they're never going to get to the level of capital they probably would need. And if anybody's really interested in that, you should read The Banker's New Clothes by Martin Helwig and Anand and Mahdi on capital. But you can pick your number, whether it's 30% or 20% or 40%. You're not going to get there. But you may get to a combination of measures which collectively force them to internalize enough costs such that the business model isn't sustainable, and it does on their own, the public markets. If the public markets actually priced these activities, these banks, relative to their actual risk, without government bailouts, they'd be gone, you know, I don't know, very, very quickly. They'd be broken up by themselves.
It's also worth saying when you frame it in that way that if you ask the public what industrial activities they think appropriate for public subsidy, speculative trading and financial markets would not be very high.
Fairly low.
Okay, we're out of time, unfortunately, but I have a couple of announcements I want to make, and they're all good ones. Number one is that anytime anybody writes a book, it's time for reflection, comments, and questions, but also a time for celebration. It's one of the many books and the last book that John Kay has published, so it's available for sale right at the entrance of the auditorium, and I believe John Kay has agreed kindly to sign, autograph some of them. Second point, I want to thank Better Markets and the great team of Dennis Keller, who've been working with for putting this together, for making this happen and partnering with SAIS on this. And so to thank you all for coming, I'm warmly inviting you to a reception, which is sponsored by my colleague, Professor Doran, who runs the IPE program, is kindly picking up the tab for wine and cheese. And I picked out the wine myself, and it's a very nice, I think it's a Spanish Rioja, and it's a very good, or the equivalent of a good Sancerre, so you should stay for that at least. But let me thank John Kay for coming and talking about his book, and Dennis Keller and Better Markets for his insightful comments. Thank you all.